بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله أوله بلا أول كان قبل وآخره بلا آخر يكون بعده الذي قصرت عن رؤيته أبصار الناظرين وعجزت عن نعته أوهام الواصفين ثم الصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا طبيبنا وحبيب إله رب العالمين بالقاسم المصطفى محمد اللهم صل على محمد وعلى الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين سيما بقية الله العظم بقية الله خير لكم إن كنتم مؤمنين ولعنة الداعم على أعدائهم وغاصبي حقوقهم ومنكري فذائلهم أجمعين من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين أما بعد في زيارة الأربعين في زيارة الإمام حسين عليه السلام أنا قتيل الأبرة صلى الله على محمد وعلى محمد Tonight we would like to discuss on the reality of crying, which is part and parcel of azadari of Imam Hussain alayhi salam. And particularly there is a discussion in regards to the statement that occurs in the ziyarat of Arba'een of Imam Hussain or in other ziyarat, that where he is considered as the one who have been killed for tears. Now, prior to the discussion in regards to what abara really means, we would like to look at crying itself on the basis of the Quran and riwayat, and what is the reality of it when a person cries, and what is it really? There are about 7 times Quran have used, there are about 7 verses in the Quran which talks about crying. For example, the brothers of Yusuf, they came crying to the father, or father, when he was parting farewell, he was crying when Yusuf was leaving. Or the heaven and earth will not cry, for example. Or it is he who makes people laugh and makes people cry, for example. And in regards to the when the signs are showed, then they will fall crying in the sajda, for example. So crying itself, if you look at it, it's the element of water in the khilqat of insan, because human beings, they are made of different elements. We have in us fire, we have in us air, we have in us earth, and we have in us water as well. These are the 4 elements. And the atibba, the doctors in the past, that's how they used to discuss the human body as. For example, you would find the Akhwan al-Safa, who have about 4 volumes on creation itself, the mysteries behind the creation. Ikhwan were very famous, they were Ismailis however, but they were very famous in terms of their mystical and philosophical understanding of the being, and they have written extensively. So water, which is one of the element, and when a person cries, that's what it comes out through his tears. It is water which he has within him. Now, when we look at the symbolic aspect of water, it symbolizes as knowledge. Water is symbolized as knowledge. If someone sees in his dream that he is drinking water or he is swimming in the ocean, that means knowledge will be provided to him. That means he is swimming in the bahar, in the ocean. And other traditions as well, which indicate the symbolic value of water as knowledge. So now, these tears usually come about on the basis of knowledge. The source of tears is knowledge. when a person comes to his limitation and he realizes how low, how limited he is, his cries, that is knowledge. When a person comes to the understanding that the only way that the husband would agree is that if she cries, she cries. That's why it's known as the tears of the wife is known as sword, right? So it's that knowledge and the manifestation of that knowledge, which is water, symbolized as, which is within insan, it manifests out in the form of tears. It's all connected. Then, obviously, just I'll mention one point in the margin, how the atibba, or how the hukama, you know, the hakims or the urafa, they contemplate in these ayat. For example, the source of jealousy is known as fire, and fire is also our element. You know, fire is in our body, and that is why you would always find that, you know, jealousy burns away the iman as if the wood burns away, as if the fire burns away the wood. So if one, see, I think I had mentioned either here or in other place, and most of the brothers and sisters are present there as well, all of the realities that exist outside is within us here. You know, as the hadith is dedicated to Hazrat Amir, there is no correct references that it is from Hazrat Amir, and that is, have you regarded yourself as a little creation? There's a whole universe is inside you. So you have this macrocosm, which is the whole universe, whatever the creation is. And there is this microcosm, which is insan. And in this microcosm, you have the macrocosm. Everything is in us. So if one really ponder and reflect, what happened to Hazrat Luqman? How come he come to the realization of that reality? Through what? Because how did he become Hakim? Because he pondered, because he reflected. And from that land of Sudan, you know, there comes a man who is, you know, Hakim, right? So what I'm trying to point out here is that it's very much required, and that is why Quran emphasizes us to contemplate. Tadabbur wa tafakkur. So we really have to contemplate on these things. The hadith that we hear, the verse of the Quran that is recited, the dua that we recite, and the ahwalat and the different states of our nafs. You know, we become happy, we become sad. You know, this happiness itself, what is it? Where does it come from? Why a person becoming happy? Requires that contemplation. When he contemplates, perhaps this happiness is not really, you know, that one should be happy about, you know. لِكَيْلَا تَأْسُوا عَلَى مَا فَاتَاكُمْ وَلَا تَفْرَغُوا عَلَى مَا أَتَاكُمْ. You know, one should, perhaps a person will become happy and he will be proud of being happy, where it shouldn't be the case, as we were reciting, you know, أَحْمَدُكَ عَلَى السَّرَّاءِ وَعَلَى الضَّرَّاءِ. You know, I praise Allah on joyous occasion and also when I'm sad. So that tadabbur and tafakkur is that which Quran is asking us to do. On every affair, on every step that a person is taking, and where this relates to, and why did this happen, and why it was meant to be this way, not that way. So crying, if you look at it, it's a reality of insan. Everybody cries. It's very natural, and he has to, because he has made from that element of water. Now, what does it do, and what does it bring about? As one would say that crying is considered to be the source of mercy. Rahmat is through crying. You know, when a person cries, wa buka al faqidin, you know, as we recite in Dua Kumail, and many other duas, like in Dua Abu Hamza as well, you know, that a person shed his tears out of love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and these tears will bring about mercy of Allah. It is through crying extract the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? What happened at a time where Yunus alayhi salam separate the children from the mothers, let the children cry, in order that the rahmat comes, in order that the azab is taken away and lifted away. You see? What is the source of that? Is those tears? Is those cries? Whether that be on that zahiri form as outward, you know, or that batini form, whether that be crocodile tears or whether that be real tears, and the crocodile tears also works, you know, right? The husbands are smiling here, I don't know why they are smiling. So therefore, I mean, it has that element of bringing that blessing or mercy or achieving that goal of that person who is crying. It is expressed through tears. So the philosophical aspect of tears is that. Now, let's move on to some of the traditions that come about in regards to crying in relation to Abu Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala. Imam says in a hadith, Ana qatilul abara. Now, there is a difference of opinion in regards to this abara, which some of them say that it is ibrat. You know, in Ziyarat al-Arba'in also we recite that, you know, my salutations to the Imam who is qatilul abara, who have been qatil is killed. Now, killed for abara, is it meaning, really means ibrat? But when we look at the, you know, dictionaries, when we look at the lexicon, we find the lexicographers have defined abara as tears as well. They have said that it is that numbness of the eyes that appears, or some extent, and also they say that it is, no, it is that tear that flows through the cheek is also abara, is known as abara. Or when we look at other hadiths, you know, we are not basing this definition of abara, you know, where Imam Hussain is saying, Ana qatilul abara, or O Hussain, you are the one who have been killed for abara. Let's, some say ibrat, some say lesson, you know, so that we should take lesson from the martyrdom of Imam Hussain alayhi salam. You know, that's what they have said. Now, let's look at the aspect of abara in other hadiths, so that when we are saying this really mean tears, is it right or not according to the Masumeen alayhim salam. We find this hadith from Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, who says that, Ya abrata kulli mu'min. You know, oh, in regards to Imam Hussein, oh, the one who is the tears of every mu'min. Now, one would say that this abara could also mean the lesson for every mu'min as well, right? So once again, but at the same time, it could be that the tear of every mu'min is Abu Abdullah. You know, every mu'min will cry for Abu Abdullah al-Husayn. In another hadith, we tend to find where it says, "Ana qatilul abara, la yathkuruni mu'min illa baka." You know, I am the one who have been killed for tears, and no mu'min, there will be not my zikr done that he would do buka, you know, which is crying in, who sob, so to speak. So this abara aspect, where Imam is saying that I am qatilul abara, is, the scholars have mentioned that is really tears. Now, when we look at what Imam is trying to point out to here, is that ana qatilul abara means that when the third one was killed, and the murder was conspired or was mentioned that this is by Hazrat Amir, they started to lament, they started to cry in the houses in Sham and Syria, and they kept that alive. The sunnat of crying was kept alive among the Mawiites, among the Shamites. And when they did that, and finally they said, Bal نُقَاتِلُكَ بُغْدًا إِنْ إِنَادًا مِنَّا لَا أَبِيكَ وَمَا فَعَلَ. They say that it is because of the bughd that we have of your father in our hearts, and that's why we have come to kill you. So how they kept this bughd alive in their hearts is through the tears that they used to shed. So when Imam is saying that Ana Qatilul Abara is because I have been killed because of these tears. Because these tears kept flowing in the houses of Sham and now they have come to kill me. And while they were attacking Ali Akbar alayhi salam, while they were attacking Imam Hussain alayhi salam, it's in return of what your father have done in Badr and Hunain. It is in return of what you have done. You know. So these tears have kept that bughd alive in their hearts by which they have revenge from Abu Abdullah al-Hussein. So here, Ana Qatilul Abara, or my salutations to the Imam who is Qatilul Abara in Ziyarat Arba'in when we recite. It really means that the Imam is saying that I have been killed because of these tears. Now, if we take a deeper meaning of these tears, as we were saying, the philosophy or the reality of tears, what tears are. We said that tears have the element of attracting the mercy, whether that be of Allah or whether that be a little child, he is crying just for the attraction, just for the favor that he wants from the mother or from the father. You know, that he will cry and through these tears he will attract his father or mother or the wife, he will attract the husband or vice versa these days, right? So therefore, what happens is that where a person cries, he will attract and he will bring about that softness of the heart vis-a-vis that person. You know, that heart will become soft and then he would, you know, fulfill the desire. So now here, when we look at the purpose of the Nabi is Rahmatul Lil Alameen, is for mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet have been sent. The quality of mercy amongst the Muslims at that time was completely forgotten. And it wasn't long where the Prophet have left the Islamic Ummah. They were returning back to the Sunnat-e-Jahiliyyah. And this battle that took place in Muharram is one of the greatest example that even the Jahil, the Johala, even those, you know, they would not fight in the month of Muharram. So that means that they have even trespassed or even, you know, gone past that level of Jahalat that they came and fought Imam Hussain alayhi salam in Muharram. Not only that, but they fought the grandson of the Prophet in Muharram. You know. So therefore, the quality of mercy there was a vacuum of the quality of mercy amongst the Muslim Ummah. So now, as we were talking about the phenomena of tears, is mercy, is knowledge. So when Imam is saying that Ana Qatilul Arab Abara, is that I have been killed for tears, so that the Ummah have mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that there be mercy amongst each other. Because it is through the death, because it is through the sacrifice, it is through the killing, and in that fashion that the Imam was killed, will bring about the tears in the Ummah, will bring about that meher and mercy and kindness in the hearts of people, where even when they were attacking the tents, when Hormala attacked and when Asghar was raised, they also started crying. So that aspect of tears is that important, because that is part and parcel of human being, part and parcel of human reality, and that has to be there. You know, one cannot shun this reality that exists in insan, which is tears. It is very automatic and it is very natural. And the essence of these tears is nothing but that mercy, whether that be mercy in that horizontal form, whether that be mercy in that vertical form. So it has that element. So when Imam is saying that I have been killed for tears, is that my killing, my murder is that you guys cry. Now, we can compare the hadith where Hazrat Siddiqah Tahira mentions that what will happen, and then Imam or the Prophet says that a qawm, a people, a nation will be there who would shed tears, who would do that. Now this shedding tears is not emotional, it has that aspect. We are not, because see, every action of a person is not just on one level. It is on all different levels. And that's the beauty of Islam. That's the beauty of the Qiyam of Abdullah al-Hussein al-Islam, that he is even calculating that. Leave aside justice, leave aside Amar bil Maruf, leave aside, you know, reform in the Ummah. You know, leaving all that aside, he has this element within it as well. I mean, when we are saying it has this element, this is nothing but the proof itself that all of the other domains are in full perfection. That it is covering all bases. That it covers reforms, it covers seerah, it covers Islam, it covers... Because, you know, the qiyam of Imam Hussein is not just the qiyam on that zahiri political or leadership. We are talking about Islam here, and Islam means the whole khilqat-e wujudiyya insan. It's everything, you know, for this jahan and for the jahan-e akhirah. You know, it should appeal and it should have every little element of insaniyat in it. So when Imam is mentioning that I've been killed for tears, is that they cry, and through this they bring about that mercy of Allah. No wonder we find in the hadith which says that if a person cries for Abu Abdullah, man dhukirna inda fafadat aynahu walau mithla janah ba'udatin. You know, if our zikr is done and through their eyes a tear comes which is equivalent to the wing of a mosquito, غُفِرَ لَهُ ذُنُوبُهُ, Allah will forgive the sins. كَانَتْ مِثْلَ زَبَدَةِ الْبَحَرِ, if even be in the abundance of the ocean. Just one tear. أَنَا قَتِلُ الْأَبَرَى. What is this tear for Abu Abdullah al-Hussein alayhi salam is doing? It is this tear which is becoming the source of our salvation. It is this tear which is becoming the source of forgiveness of our sins. We are not looking at the other aspect here, which is justice and what will happen, you know, how the heart will go towards the message and all that. No. We are just looking at this one reality at present, which is that ashk, which is that tear, which is the essential quality of an insan, which is, because he's one of them is water, you know. In another hadith, which says, Salat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. This is a bit of a detailed hadith, which talks about the different levels of these tears. He says, when our zikr is mentioned, when the zikr of Ahlul Bayt is mentioned, and when the zikr of Imam Hussein alayhi salam is mentioned, لِقَتْلِ الْحُسَيْنِ ibn Ali, if the eye shed tears, he will be provided فِي الْجَنَّةِ غُرُفًا. You know, he will be provided with a room in the Jannah. And then if this tear flows through his cheek, then he will be provided with the Jannah Mubawwa Sidqin, you know, which is a Jannah of Sidq. And then if his heart is affected by the pain that and the suffering that we had, then, which includes the tear, then for him it will be where he will be in a state of Amn Yawm Al-Qiyamah Min sakhatihi wan-nar, you know, the hellfire, he will be kept away from it. The qahariyat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not reach him. One is the outward aspect of that tear, where he will be provided with that zahiri jannah. The other is that it affects him and it flows, which is the maqam of sidq. And that pain affects where he is protected from the qahariyat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the zahiri aspect of it, and then the batini aspect of it. So that means that when a person is crying for Abu Abdullah al-Hussein, he should take this tear to that batini aspect, not just stay here. He has to really take it to that level where he would be protected from the qahariyat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In another tradition where the Imam says, Alhamdulillah, you know, praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Alladhi faddalna ala khalqi bir rahmah. Thanks to Allah that He has given us fadila, He has honored us upon the creation with rahmah. Because masumeen are the umanaw rahman. They are the minarets of mercy. That's what we recite in Ziyarat-e-Jamia. They are the minarets of mercy. So the Imam is thanking Allah that they have made us, they have honored us as mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now how they are mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he explains. وَخَصَّنَا أَهْلِ بَيْتِ بِالرَّحْمَةِ He has given us that khususiyat of rahmah, Ahl Bayt with rahmah. وَمَا بَكَى أَحَدٌ رَحْمَةً لَنَا وَلِمَا لَقَيْنَا إِلَّا رَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ قَبْلَ أَن تَخْرُجْ الدَّمْ مِنْ عَيْنِهِ He says that this mercy, وَمَا بَكَى أَحَدٌ There isn't a soul, there isn't a person who would cry and the tear would flow and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will encompass him. It will take care of him. It will shower upon him. So as the Ahlul Bayt suffering as due to or because of Ahlul Bayt a person cries, whether that be shawqan, you know, in that desire, you know, where a person also cries when he is in that joyous, when he is in the state of ecstasy and happiness, he would cry as well. You know, crying is not only in the aspect of where a person is sad or because of pain, but he also cries when he is very happy, you know. So this itself shows that it is due to that element that he has within him, you know, that fourth element of water that he has. And once again, that joy is because of what? Is based on what? You know, that joy is based on knowledge that I was given that opportunity to do the ziyarat of Abu Abdullah Hussain or Masumin. And I have the marifat of them and this is why I'm crying. You know, it just flows automatically. You know, when we go for ziyarat, it just comes about, nothing. Because we have that knowledge, that element of ilm, knowledge, symbolize, whatever we have discussed. And then it just flows. We don't really bring that. It just comes about, you know, as soon as we are in that presence. And it's been mentioned that you know, in regards to other awliya as well, you know, when a person in their, you know, state, when they see him, the people just cry. You know, when they witness the ulama or scholars who were high ranking and who have high caliber and status in terms of that ruhaniyat, people will attend to their service and they just cry. They cannot speak. You know, because of that awe, because of that presence. Based on what? Based on knowledge. So therefore, tears is very natural to the human psyche, to human beings. So now here, Imam is mentioning that we thank Allah because we are the source of mercy. Now, what is the proof that they are the source of mercy? Because the eyes will cry for them. Whether shawqan or in the state where they are in... they are suffering. If the Ahlul Bayt suffers, the eyes will cry as well. If the eyes will cry out of shawq as well, out of desire. So that essential quality of descending of mercy is our tears. And that is happening because of that Imam, because of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. So it's connected. The other tradition that talks about the aspect of Abara is also where some scholars have said it is really Imam Hussain alayhi salam who have on the day or in the plain of Karbala was continuously in the state of crying. You know, he was crying for Ali Akbar, he was crying for Ali Asghar. So, you know, I was killed while I was crying. I was killed because, you know, I was continuously in the state of crying. You know, I was killed while I was in the state of crying. Now, even this cry of Abu Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam, as we have said, Ahmaduka ala sarrai wa darrai, it doesn't really make sense where he is emotionally attached as such. You know, when Hazrat, you know, Nabi Akram mentions that, you know, reports to Siddiqa Kubra that I'm leaving this dunya soon, she starts to cry. And then right after that, Hazrat says that you will be the one who will meet me first. She did not cry. So this crying of the Masumeen is not that he is my father, he is going. We would find that in the ziyarat of Shambe, with the ziyarat of Saturday, that is, we recite for the Prophet. حَيْثُ أَنَّ الْقَتَّ الْوَحِي And إِنَّ لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّ إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ is recited three times. The fiqdan of the Nabi, of the Prophet, is because the wahi is disconnected from the creation. And that is inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Not that Rasul is Rasul. Yes, on that basis is there. We are not saying, once again, it's all vertical. You know, izzatu lillahi wa li rasulihi wa lil mu'mineen. The izzat of a mu'mineen is the izzat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's vertical. So this emotionality, this cries of Abu Abdullah al-Hussein or of Siddiqa al-Kubra is from a point of view that mechanism of wahi, that connection of the khalq with the khaliq is disconnected. And then the Prophet informs in regards to that, you will be the first one to meet, which really brought that sense of joy to the heart of Hazrat. So now this crying of Abu Abdullah al-Hussein alayhi salam have that element and that aspect, that these individuals who are the awliya, who have reached the daraja of wilayat, now they are the one who are suffering, they are the one who have been the source of rahmat on this earth, they are the one who are taken away, right? And on the other hand, you have the aspect of attracting special mercies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even for waliullah, because when we say al-ubbat salas, there are three types of worshippers. One is the one who worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for Jannah. One is the one who worship for fear. And one is the one who worship because Allah deserves to be worshipped, because He loves, because of that marifat. So this principles which the Imam have mentioned fits in all categories. Even in the categories of tears. Even my tears is for three reasons. It is out of shauq, or is it out of fear that I'm losing them, or is it really out of, you know, entering that paradise, for example, or being with them, or whatever. So that tear that they have is really to attract that mercies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and that marifat that the Imam have of them, which is bringing about that emotionality for the Imam. Hazrat Yaqub, as we said, you know, they gave the example of Hazrat Yaqub when he was parting farewell from Hazrat Yusuf when the brothers took him, right? The exegetes, they have mentioned he traveled 12 cities just to see him off. And finally, when he was leaving, the father and son were crying. So this crying brings that mercy, it automatically does. So the cries of Ahl Bayt, the cries of the Imam, brings that mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Although they are fully aware and they have seen their maqamat, you know, where they will be in Jannah, right? But there is something, there is some energy, there is some reality, there is some attraction in these tears that we cannot really comprehend and understand. And this is the level that we could go to. That the awliyas cry, that the prophets they cry, that, you know, the mu'mineen and mu'minat cry, whether shawqan lillah, whether in the state of emotionality, it means that this has to be a practice, or this has to be the reality one must really entertain and engage oneself in order to excel, in order that he achieve spirituality, in order that he achieve kamalat, whether that be from a point of view of emotionality, you know, that emotional love, that very emotional episode or saga of Karbala that one hears and cry, whether that be emotional or whether that be on that level of marifat, this reality of crying has to be there and must be there for a person to really excel in terms of his spirituality. As we mentioned that verse, that when that ayat is shown, as this is a hadith where I mentioned earlier as well, that once the Prophet was in the house of Siddiqa-e-Kubra, and all of a sudden he started to cry and he'd fall in sajda. When she inquires that what happened, the Prophet replied, Allah showed me in the Alam-e-Ruh, in Mukashifa, the Maqam of Hussein, by which I started to cry and I fall in sajda. This sajda is not for Imam Hussain. This sajda is sajda of Allah, because these maqamat are vertical. It's all vertical. It's all one. So Prophet cried and then he did sajda. So what's there to crying? What's there for him to cry where, you know? So it's very natural. It is very much part and parcel of our spiritual being and required. And that's why we say, if you cannot cry, at least make the face of crying. And that is why it is emphasized there. You know, these hadiths are very much required to be discussed so that our youth, our youngsters understand. Because when we were young, we were like, okay, doesn't make sense that at least make your face like crying. You know, on the other hand, one might even say that this is munafiqiyat. You know, this is something that should be ashan. You know, one should abhor this. One should not really entertain this. If you don't feel like crying, if you don't, you know, you cannot cry, at least make your face like crying. Why is that? Because there is husn, there is some goodness in it. That is why it's even that act, which is the act of nifaq, is lifted from this act, which is for Abu Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam. You know, even that reality is nullified because of the act of crying or making the face of cry for Abu Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam. Because it melts the heart of a person. It breaks that. You know, for men it is very difficult to cry, but they have to really engage and entertain this quality of buka. As it's in tradition mentioned, it's considered as one of the weapons of a mu'min, is that buka, that is cries. And through that he excels, through that he achieves. Now if we take that hadith where that could also fit, is where he says, you know, they have killed me by making me cry so much. Ana qatilul abara, the Imam is saying that they have killed me by making me cry so much. That continuously Imam was crying on their loved ones, on the Ashab. And not only that, the traditions points out too that people have witnessed tears from the head of Imam Hussain alayhi salam. That when he saw the zulm taking place upon the Ahl Bayt alayhi salam. Today is the 11th day of Muharram, the day where they were taken captives, and when they were chained, when the ropes were tied, when they put the chains in the neck and feet of Imam Sajjad alayhi salam, look at the intensity of pain and suffering of the women and children of Abu Abdullah, of Bani Hashim, and of Ashab of Imam Hussain alayhi salam, and the Awlad of Imam Hussain alayhi salam. They ordered that we must take their loved ones through the Qatalgah, through the places where their bodies are lying without heads. Some of the Shuhada's head was taken while they were still alive. Some of the heads were severed after they killed them. We really wonder what sort of tradition this was, that they were cutting the heads of the Ali Rasul. And once they did that, they put the heads on the spears, and the heads were in front of the caravan, and they were walking behind the caravan. It's been mentioned that when they reached the body of Abu Abdullah al-Hussein, Sometimes the traditions are so intense that you would say, that really, is that really possible? And there are explanation of it that could be explained on the alam of spirit, that the hadith or the ziyarat says, my salams to the imam who had nothing on his body. We imagine the son is going through and seeing his father, who is known as the Sayyid al-Shabab of Ahl al-Jannah, and his body is there without his head, and he cannot do anything. And when Hazrat Zainab saw Imam Sajjad in this state, she moves forward and she says that, Sajjad, take care of yourself. What has happened to you? She says, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. She says, my aunt, it is not possible for me to see my father in this state where I see the enemies, they are burying their loved ones, and I cannot do anything in regards to the body of my father. The caravan moves forward and reaches Kufa. And this is the worst. And this, perhaps this is the first time that the women and children have to enter the city of Kufa, where Zainab Salamullah Alayha was known princess of this city. Zainab never traveled outside alone by herself. There was always Abbas, there was always Amirul Mumineen, there was always Hassan and Hussein who would accompany her. They would accompany Zainab, they would accompany Umm Kulthum. The ladies, they never traveled alone. And this is that very city where she was regarded and held in high esteem as the Mufassir of the Quran. And she'd been asked to enter that city where there is full of men in that city. And here Khuli says, enter. Then Zainab says, I'm not going to enter Kufa. Then Shimr orders, enter Zainab, the city of Kufa. She says, I'm not entering. Then they strike the back of Imam Sajjad alayhi salam. And then here Imam Sajjad says, aunt, enter the city of Kufa. And then finally that hour comes that she enters the courtyard of Ibn Ziyad, where there are men. At the same time, you have that city in a state of sadness as well, because there were people who loved, as Farazdakh says, that the hearts of Kufans are with you, but the swords are against you. So here she delivers that sermon where the whole city starts to cry. And it is here where she was summoned in front of men, and the orders of their arrest was given, that they should be kept in the prison of Kufa. A prison which is dark, a prison in which there is little children of Abu Abdullah al-Hussein. Perhaps the only source of relief and release for the women and children is when they would go to sleep, but there is one person in the prisoners who goes to sleep. As soon as they see that he has gone to sleep, they will come and pull the chains so that he wakes up. There was none but Imam Sajjad alayhi salam. They say that whenever he would rest, they would hurt him. And at night, it has been mentioned that when they stand up for their night prayers, Hazrat Zainab salamullah alayha is sitting and praying her night prayers. Then Imam Sajjad inquires that, oh my aunt, that we have never seen you, that you sit and pray. What has happened to you? Then she says that the food that is provided to the prisoners is so little that she gives away to the other women and children. The masaib of Ahl Bayt is intensified, and it really begins after the Shahadat of Abu Abdullah al-Hussein alayhi salam. And it is the leadership of Sayyida Zainab salamullah alayha that really brought the message of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, that saved the message of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Our salams and salutations to this great lady, Hazrat Zainab Salamullah Alayha. As-salamu alayka ya binta Rasulullah. As-salamu alayka ya binta Fatimatu Zahra. As-salamu alayka ya binta Amirul Mu'mineen. As-salamu alayka ya ukhta Waliyullah. As-salamu alayka ya ukhta Al-Hasan wal-Husayn. Wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Ala lanatullah ala qawm al-zalimeen. سيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون اللهم وندعوك باسمك العظيم الأعظم العجل الأكرم بعدد ما أحاط به علمك بمولاتي حضرت زينب سلام الله عليها يا الله 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 يا رحمن يا رحيم يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك يا قاضي الحاجات يا كافي المهمات إنك على كل شيء قدير رحم الله من قرأ الفاتحة لأرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات especially the marhumin of the brothers and sisters who are present here and all those marhumin who participated and who worked towards making the majalis, the azadari possible particularly and for the shuhada who have given their lives while attending the majalis of Abu Abdullah al-Husayn alayhi salam no matter where they were in this globe with a loud salwat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.